Hey guys, it's Norm from Tested. I'm here in San Mateo for ComBots. ComBots Cup. I'm here with Dave Calkins. You are the co-founder of ComBots.
That's correct.
And you guys also run Robo Games, right?
And we do. So ComBots does two big events every year, Robo Games in the spring, which is the International Olympics of Robots, with both combat robots as well as humanoids, autonomous robots, things like that. And in the fall, we do the ComBots Cup, which is very much based on the Stanley Cup of a traveling trophy. So teams win it and then give it back the next year and you get your name on it.
Oh, very cool. So Robo Games, I've been on that before. It's like feats of strength. You have like just all different types of robots, but that's not what ComBots, this fall event is about. This is about destroying other robots, heavy robots. And you have your own robot right here. So tell me about this robot.
This is Vlad the Impaler 2. Which is a very old robot now, first started in 2001, constantly being upgraded, and robots are a lot like computers, that, you know, they're never really done, you're always upgrading them and building better ones and things like that.
So you mentioned BattleBots, 10 years ago there were BattleBots on TV, and ComBots came after that. What was the story behind that?
There were so many people who fell in love with the sport of fighting robots, and just because the TV show went off the air didn't mean that the sport went away. So just, you know, like, it's like watching baseball, you know, you don't always go to the major league games. Sometimes you go to the minor league games, the pickup games, things like that. And so after the show went off the air, we just wanted to keep the sport going. And so here we are today with the same size arena and all the same sized robots and having a lot of fun.
Yeah, and it's a lot of the same competitors, too.
A lot of the same competitors. Once it gets in your blood, it changes your life, and which sounds very cliched, but it's the truth. Is that you get into this, and you're like, this is what I want to do. Most of the guys here have day jobs. I do, too. We all just take vacation, so this is our vacation. Instead of going to Cancun, Mexico, or whatever, we come fight robots.
You got to give me the lowdown on what the different types of weapons are for the robots. If I'm just new to combat robots and I see, you know, some with big wheels on them, some flippers, what are the different techniques?
So the different techniques, the easiest one is a wedge, which is just getting under the other robot and ramming him around. Then you have simple lifters, such as Vlad. You have pneumatic flippers, which usually have nitrogen or CO2 tanks inside. And then when they pop, it can throw the other robot all the way into the ceiling. Then you have spinning weapons, both spinning bars, spinning discs, and spinning drums, which basically cut open the other robot. Flamethrowers, which don't do a lot of damage, but look really cool. And then a couple other random robots that people are always coming up with new and unique ideas.
And then they all use pretty standard motors, 3 to 5 horsepower motors?
Everybody uses a slightly different brand, but yeah, they're all 3 to 5 horsepower.
And when you're in the cage, what are the rules? I mean, you just go at it and...
It's very much like boxing, so it's a 3-minute match. You go at it, really no holes barred. You're not allowed entanglement devices or electronic weapons, but that's it. And you just beat the crap out of the other guy until you either knock him out or 3 minutes is up, much like boxing, and then it goes to the judges.
Wow, and these robots, I mean, you want to repair them between matches. Do you take certain pride if you get a robot completely out of commission and they're unable to be repaired?
Yeah, there's a lot of pride in being able to come into the pits and turn a robot around in 40 minutes, not just, you know, charging the batteries, but holy crap, they ripped off, you know, the whole front end, and you have to do that. And just like NASCAR or anything else, there are some teams that are a lot better than others at that. Some teams, you know, you can be damaged and that's it, you're out, because you're not going to be able to repair that for 4 days. Other guys can turn their robot around in, you know, an hour or two, because they're just much better at it.
So Vlad the Impaler 2, you fought yesterday. Tell me how your fights went.
I'm not the best competitor in the world. I try to focus more on getting the competitors here. So Vlad's first fight was against Mosquito. We did better on aggression than on damage, but damage counts for more points, so we lost the fight. And then the second fight, Vlad got flipped over and the power switch actually got turned off. And
oh, no. The old power switch. It's the robot's big weakness,
yep.
Power button.
Sneak in and you push that button and that's the end of the fight.
Well... Good luck next year. You run the event. You can basically do this whenever you want. But
theoretically, yeah. In practice, it's more like our two vacations of the year, and we do this. And then we need a vacation after the vacation.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Dave. We're going to talk to a few more competitors and then check out some actual fights.
You're going to enjoy it.
I'm here with Fuzzy Mauldin. You are Team Toad, the singular member with your robot, right?
That's right. Well, I mean, the whole family's Team Toad, but I'm here by myself this time, so I'm Team Toad.
and your robot is a Blizzard. This is your 12th year competing in ComBots?
This is my 12th year of competing in combat robotics. I think my first ComBots event was 2006.
All right, so tell me a little bit about the Blizzard.
Blizzard is a what we call a heavyweight robot. It's 220 pounds or 100 kilograms. It is a four-wheeled spinner. It has tank drive. The left side wheels work together, the right side wheels work together, and it can spin in place. And then on the front, we have a 32-pound spinning drum made out of S7 tool steel, heat-treated to a hardness of C50. And it spins about 3,600 RPM. My goal is either to throw him or, absent that, parts of him well across the arena.
So let's take a look underneath the hood, though.
Sure.
It's not too complex in terms of, you know, RC-controlled machines go.
It's really very simple. It's probably no more complicated than your average remote control racing car, at least the tank drive. There's two motors. This is the 3-inch amp flow. That's about, you know, 3.5 to 4 horsepower motor. It's got a planetary gearbox that does, I think, an 8-to-1 reduction, and then that drives a chain reduction. So this spins very fast compared to the tires. And underneath the electronics is a companion that operates the right side. We have a receiver that talks to the remote control, and that's just a standard Futaba aviation style remote control. We have a battery for the radio. We have 5 batteries for drive and weapon. This relay controls this relay and that relay. These are contactors, big relays. This is a small relay that runs off this receiver battery. This provides power to the weapon, and this provides a braking action by shorting the motor out. These never are on at the same time. That would be bad.
And then you have a separate motor also for the weapon.
We have a separate 4-inch mag motor. We actually have an overdrive if you want to look at the chains here. But see, we have 19 teeth on this sprocket and only 15 teeth here. So we're actually driving the weapon faster than the weapon motor is turning. So we have overdrive on the motor.
And also a braking system, because that's going to spin for a long time after
the fight. Right, yeah, there's a rule. When you're done with the fight, you're supposed to be able to spin down in 60 seconds.
Yeah.
That's basically so that we don't have the audience bored waiting around and keep the competition going. Well, when I clocked it without the brake, it took 2 minutes and 5 seconds to spin down, which means I got almost all the friction out of it, which is normally a good thing unless you have... So we put the brake in, it spins down in about 40 seconds now.
When other people are fighting the Blizzard, what is their strategy to take you out of commission?
Well, the one I fought yesterday, it was a flipper, and it took him 12 seconds to get me upside down.
Oh, no.
But I basically kept running over him until he flipped me again, and then I was right side up. And then I got one good hit, and see, I have a little secret weapon here. I have this 3-pound tooth made out of 3-inch chromoly steel. This rides right along the ground, and that gets under other wedges. And so when I got under his wedge, he fired his weapon, he caught himself on a part of his own robot and immobilized himself. He drove up the robot, hit this, and his whole robot just rode up on top of mine. And I chewed up on underneath him for a while.
Nice.
And you could see shavings coming off in the video. It was glorious.
So how do you practice with the Blizzard? Do you like take it to a parking lot? Do you make dummy robots? Like,
well, I used to have a restaurant in Pittsburgh where you could fight robots. So when we closed, we gave away 2 of our big arenas to Dave Calkins, who's walking by me right here. And those were his first arenas to run ComBots and Robo Games. And I kept the small one for myself, so I keep that in the shop. So I actually have a tiny version. We call it the Tiny Toad Tank. It's 12 foot by 12 foot, but it has 1-inch Lexan, heavy steel, 8-inch steel floor. And I use that to have a safe place to spin this up in my own shop. This is the best robot I know how to build right now. It's better than a lot of them, but there's one robot out there that I don't know how to beat yet. And I'm a lot of people are in that boat. If all goes well, I have 4 or 5 fights today. So after 2 o'clock, I will hope to be one crazy guy. On the other hand, I'm on the loser side of the bracket. So if I lose, I go home. So I could only have 1 more fight. But I favor my chances against the Great Pumpkin, and I owe him a whooping, so I'm going to try and deliver it.
Blizzard starts to spin up at this. Great Pumpkin takes the center of the ring.
beautiful seal spots on the... Oh, there's a flamethrower over the gate. It's working this time.
Up to 15 seconds. Ray Pumpkin using all the seconds of energy. Goes down and turn the group. We're going to get this right. And we're going to see the right side up again.
I'm here with Gary Jin. You are the builder, the head lead builder for Original Sin, your robot behind you. This is the robot that's won for the past 3 years, the ComBots Cup, right?
Yes, we have. We're the only team to have won the ComBots Cup more than one time, and we've done it the last 3 years, which is a huge accomplishment.
What is the secret behind Original Sin's success? What type of robot is this? What type of BattleBot?
It's a very simple wedge robot. All I do is I go after the other guy, wedge under him, slam him against the wall, hopefully knock him out. I think the reason Original Sin does so well is because of its simplicity. It does absolutely what it needs to do and nothing more.
And have you made improvements this year to Original Sin? Better wedge, stronger flip?
Just more spares. Just getting being able to repair in between fights is very important.
Gary, what do you do? What is your day job when you're not building Original Sin?
When I'm not building Original Sin, I'm designing and building electronics.
So electronics is your background, and then killer robots is your hobby.
Yeah, that's right. I started racing RC cars as a hobby, and that's why probably why I'm able to drive Original Sin so well.
Well, good luck on your competition today, and we'll have to check them out in the cage.
All right, thanks.
And they take time to get the weapons up to full speed. They come closer to the...